band who built a new wave of heavy metal out of the crumbling ruins of punk and speeded rock and roll up until it almost left the ground. Led by their fearsome leader, Lemmy, 6 feet plus of visceral vocal onslaught and pounding strumming bass, their music would define two new genres of rock and roll, speed metal and thrash metal.
Lemmy was the godfather. You know, he was the one that, if it weren't for Lemmy, we wouldn't be here.
No, Guns N' Roses, Nirvana, Alice in Chains, Nine Inch Nails, modern rock music would be completely different.
Motorhead's founder and leader, Lemmy Kilmister, would grow up to be Jimi Hendrix's roadie, soak up the music of 60s London, get arrested with drugs hidden in his underwear, and finally form his own band, Motorhead.
Motorhead was one of the main reasons that I wanted to start a band myself and play music.
But behind the band's fearsome stage appearances were hidden some human tragedies that would take their toll on this wayward band of brothers. But nothing would stop Lemmy.
There's only one Lemmy, and there'll never be one. There wasn't one before, and there ain't gonna be one after.
I'm gonna get hold of this camera and f***ing ram it down your f***ing throat.
This is the blood and guts, lust, drugs, and musical rollercoaster ride that is the story of Lemmy and his band. This is Motorhead, the story behind the music. The story of Motorhead is the story of metal music in all its glorious incarnations. They're considered forefathers of both thrash and speed metal. They ruled the world with an uncompromising sound and attitude, and terrified those who saw them.
I couldn't believe just how ugly this guy was. You know, he was scary looking.
He scared the shit out of me.
F***ing artist, I'm sensitive as shit.
And it blew my mind. I've never seen anything like it in my life.
Keith Richards times 10.
Very intimidating. Got the mic up high. Got the mutton chops.
Everyone's always been afraid of these guys.
Get the f*** out of my dressing room.
I threatened to throw him out the window.
Move over for a damage game.
On the band's journey, its leader, Lemmy, was to face a series of emotional crises. Lemmy's roommate, Andy Elsmore, would be murdered in a gay hate crime. His long-standing comrade in music, Wurzel, would die of heart failure. And the love of his life would overdose and drown in the bathtub. Kill my death. Kill my death. Kill my death. 40 years later, they are still playing rock and roll and living up to their lock up your daughter's reputation as world-class hellraisers and high-octane, foot-on-the-floor bad boys.
All this stuff. No, you shouldn't smoke, you shouldn't drink too much, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that. It doesn't apply to that, mate.
Music!
No one who hears their music is ever quite the same again.
First time I saw Motorhead or heard of them was that Young Ones episode where they played Ace of Spades.
Rock, it was metal, it was punk, and it was blues. And you just get this incredible noise.
I'm so bad, baby, I don't care.
A cacophonous double bass. It was loud as f***.
And I hadn't seen anything that balls to the wall, sort of rock and roll in a while.
And I instantly became completely addicted.
If there wasn't a Motorhead, there wouldn't be a Metallica.
Ah, the epitome of rock and roll, you know.
Same horrible f***ing band, you know, and people are still queuing up to see it.
They embraced all they considered a prerequisite of rock and roll. Drugs, whiskey, women, gambling. More drugs, more whiskey, and more women.
I don't think anything can prepare you for working with Lemmy, really, until they actually go through it.
They built their image with a cool glass in one hand and a hot woman in the other, even if Lemmy is considered a loner.
He's definitely not in bed by 10 with a glass of milk kind of guy.
They had number one albums, top 10 singles, sellout crowds, innovative songs, and groundbreaking tours. In the end, everybody loved them, except the music industry.
I looked up to Motorhead because I always felt like nobody told them what to do.
I love Lemmy's attitude because he's just like, hey, if you don't like it, off. I don't make music thinking about you.
Lemmy Kilmister, the man known for his mutton chop sideburns, gravelly voice, and of course the most famous facial warts in rock and roll, was born on Christmas Eve 1945 in industrial Stoke-on-Trent in the cold West Midlands of England. His father, a Royal Air Force chaplain, soon abandoned the family, and Lemmy and his mother, with little money or prospects, moved to the coast.
Options were probably to work on a farm or work on a farm. Or you could work on a chicken farm, you know, specialize.
Lemmy didn't fit in at school. He was soon expelled for cutting class and took casual jobs at summer fairs and at a horse riding school. He had other interests.
You want to get laid, mostly. But then you realize that it only lasts for half an hour, so you better find something else to occupy your time as well. Oh, come on, everybody, let's
get together tonight. Lemmy found music.
I think it was Eddie Cochran and Gene Vincent who came over from the States and they were on there together. And chicks were all over them. I thought, wow, that looks like the job for me, you know. I can stand a bit of that.
He took a job at a washing machine factory and taught himself to play the guitar.
It worked like a charm. I was immediately surrounded by women of all shapes and religious persuasions. It was great.
He had the women. Now all he needed was a band. So he swapped the remote seaside town for London with its hard rock, loud music, soft women, and seductive southern comforts.
When I went down, I only knew one guy in London, and that was Neville, who was Hendrix's roadie.
Within weeks, he scored a job as a roadie for this former American paratrooper who was already fast becoming a guitar legend.
I got to watch Hendrix every night for nothing. Are you kidding?
It was a shared love of amphetamines that brought Lemmy in touch with a musician named Dick Mick, who was a member of the psychedelic rock band Hawkwind. One day, the band showed up without their bass player for an outdoor London gig, and Lemmy seized his chance.
So Dave Box says, who plays bass? And Dick Mick went, he does. I said, you bastard, you know, I never picked one up in my life. Seriously, never touched one. As we go on stage, Nicky Turner, that fountain of wisdom, says to me, imperishable advice, make some noises in E, this is called You Shouldn't Do That, and walks away from me, you know.
The rest is history. Lemmy would be with the band for 4 years and sing lead vocals on their biggest hit, Silver Machine.
We're all quite weird-looking characters. The band themselves were all quite strange-looking characters for a start, and Lemmy fitted in wonderfully well.
They were kind of like this, you know, peace, love, flower, power, hippie band.
But tragedy was about to rudely invade the peace and love world of Hawkwind.
My dad once went out with a woman that he really fell in love with when he was very young. I mean, he must have been about 17.
The woman was a dancer called Sue.
Yeah, well, they weren't going well for Sue, you know, because she went off doing a job in Beirut dancing. Came back with this massive smack habit.
When Lemmy returned home one day, he found Sue dead in the bathtub from a heroin overdose.
That's what happened to my generation, you know. He got sucked on his tracks by heroin, you know. That's why I hate it.
He really loved this girl. He found her dead in the tub, and as I can recall, he sat in an armchair for like 3 days.
Some of the time you can't even picture her face, but I can picture Susie.
Coming up, Lemmy gets fired from Hawkwind, forms Motorhead, and ends up recording one of the greatest metal anthems of all time.
I would rather have Ace of Spades than $1 million in the bank. The only kind of need is the Ace of Spades, the Ace of Spades.
when Behind the Music continues. Lemmy has moved to London from his hometown in the cold north of England, lost the love of his life to heroin, and joined the band Hawkwind. But when they stopped for lunch on tour in Niles, Michigan, his musical dream started unraveling too.
I don't know what the f*** happened then. I was out with my camera snapping pictures and I got smacked over the head by some bastard and mugged him.
We couldn't find him anywhere. He'd vanished.
They stole my camera and my money.
And we just drove off and left him.
They're gone without me, which is another instance of how cosmic they were.
With the band due on stage that night, Lemmy had no choice but to get back on the road, hitchhiking to Detroit.
I got rides with VW buses full of hippies, homosexual truckers. He was a big lad and all. I was glad to get out of that door. And I finally wound up in Detroit at about 7 in the morning.
Hitchhiker Kilmister made it on stage, but the next day at the Canadian border, his luck ran out when he was searched.
And they found some white powder on him.
I got busted for what they charged me with. It was cocaine, but it wasn't. It was speed, so it was wrongful arrest, so the case was dismissed.
We were playing in Toronto the next day, and they kept Lemmy overnight, which was the final straw.
And they fired me at 4 that morning because they couldn't get my replacement over there fast enough, apparently.
He was really pissed off, of course, you know, and upset.
Lemmy decided to form his own blues-based rock band, modeled after Detroit's MC5, mixed with elements of Little Richard. They took their name from the last song he ever wrote for Hawkwind, Motorhead.
It's American slang for speed freak, or like motor mouth, motorhead, you know.
Alongside Lemmy were Larry Wallace on guitar and Lucas Fox on drums. The band got a contract with Hawkwind's label, United Artists, but their first effort at an album was considered so poor, the label refused to release it.
They tried so hard to kill us when we started. They are the best worst band in the world, we were voted in sound, yeah. Not just the worst band, the best worst band in the world.
It's a brilliantly accurate description of them, and one that I think actually the band and Lemmy in particular would kind of embrace.
Lemmy reacted by firing drummer Lucas Fox and hiring Phil Taylor, but he needed a nickname.
There was a girl called Motorcycle Irene, who at the time was my girlfriend. In the very early days of Motorhead, she used to call me a filthy animal for sexual reasons.
Filthy Animal's drumming was to fast become a trademark of the band.
Listen to his drum tracks. They're f***ing insane. It's like, ah! It just feels and sounds like he's just running down a hall naked.
Lemmy now replaced Larry Wallace with guitarist Fast Eddie Clark.
I was in bed and the door goes and I go to open the door and it was quite early. And I've opened the door and there's Lemmy standing there with a leather jacket and a bullet belt. And he probably handed them to me, he said, you got the job. And then walked off.
This lineup would last for 7 years, 8 albums, and dozens of tours. It quickly became a key part of the new wave of British heavy metal.
Motorhead is the band that helped create, you know, metal in the form that it is today.
Lemmy was the godfather. You know, he was the one that, if it weren't for Lemmy, we wouldn't be here.
If there wasn't a Motorhead, there wouldn't be a Metallica.
No, Guns N' Roses, Nirvana, Alice in Chains, Nine Inch Nails, modern rock music would be completely different.
The band was now working well together on stage, but off stage, fists were flying.
Phil was the chief hellraiser, actually. Phil and Eddie were always fighting each other.
Artists, sensitive as
after a certain point, Phil starts lashing out.
I find it very similar to England. Stop doing that, else I'm going to nut you.
You know, we'd have a good fight, punch each other a couple of times. and then we'd have a laugh about it.
Motorhead was playing gigs and recording, but the world wasn't listening.
Nobody wanted to sign Motorhead because everybody was scared of us, because we looked like nutters, you know what I mean? And plus the music was, for them days, it was a bit raw.
Soon they were penniless and living in a squat.
We didn't have a pot to piss. We were starving in the early days. I mean, we didn't have nothing. I mean, nothing.
It looked like the end of the road for the band.
Lemmy said, we're breaking up, we've had enough, we can't take any more of this.
Then Chiswick Records offered the band two last chance days in a remote rural studio to pull it all together.
The behemoth that was Motorhead descended, as did a pile of white powder.
They sounded fantastic. A lot of energy. This went in and went for it.
I think they stayed a week for days.
The album Motorhead charted at 43. But a few months later, with the band about to headline its own tour, Phil got into a fight with a roadie over a girl.
And then he said the wrong thing, and I just smacked him on it right in the mouth and broke my knuckles.
This time it's so bad that we've had to cancel the tour.
So what are you going to do?
What Lemmy did was more, not less, recording two Motorhead albums in 1 year, Overkill and Bomber.
Overkill to me is like a 747 just flying, like, you know, 5 feet over your head. There's so much power in that.
Overkill and Bomber were great records. I thought they were awesome. I'll Be Your Sister. I mean, come on. That was my wedding song.
Then in 1980, the gambler Lemmy and his band played an unbeatable hand with Ace of Spades.
The riff is just, I mean, as soon as that comes in, you know, it's instantly recognizable and instantly just sort of grabs you by the balls.
Just the core of it is rock and roll, and that's what I loved about it so much.
That's why Motorhead's music lasts, is because they knew where it came from, which is the blues.
There hadn't been anything quite like that, and it broke a mold.
You hear it, and it sounds like a thunderstorm coming.
It amazes me.
I mean, is there anybody that's ever looked more badass than on the cover of Ace of Spades?
Rather have Ace of Spades than £1 million in the bank. You know, because Ace of Spades will be here after I'm gone, and it's a classic.
With Ace of Spades spiraling up the charts, Lemmy turned his mind to finding a support band for the upcoming tour.
That's the way I like it, baby. I don't want to live forever.
When he first met us in the rehearsal studio, he went back to his band and said, by the way, the blonde's mine.
The blonde was Kelly Johnson, and the band was Girl School, a heavy metal outfit from South London. They recorded Please Don't Touch with Motorhead, which reached number 5 on the UK chart.
I seem to remember Eddie throwing his guitar across the bloody studio, having a fit, you know.
Coming up, Lemmy faces some dramatic personal challenges, and the disintegration of the classic lineup begins.
Filthy left because basically he thought that the secret of his future career lay with Brian Robertson.
Yeah, and to get away from Lemmy.
When Behind the Music continues. Chart success had catapulted Motorhead into the high life, but being high had a cost. After years of amphetamine abuse, Lemmy realized that his body was beginning to destroy itself from within.
My manager, Keith Richard, had his blood changed in Switzerland, right?
And it was then clean, you know, and it was marvelous and healthy and all that.
But then the doctor took samples of Lemmy's blood.
Also, he said, don't let him give any blood transfusions. He said, he no longer has real blood. He said, it's toxic.
All this stuff. You shouldn't smoke, you shouldn't drink too much, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that. Didn't apply to Lemmy.
The transfusion was canceled. But there was another medical emergency when Phil Taylor challenged a roadie to lift him above his head.
He fell over backwards and I went down and landed on my head, which was a bit painful. And so that's how I broke my neck.
The band kissed goodbye to another tour. But once Taylor was healthy enough to resume playing, they hit the road again. This time recording all their English gigs for a live album, No Sleep Till Hammersmith, which reached number one on the UK charts.
They didn't sleep the whole tour until they got to Hammersmith in London, and they still played this brilliant show.
Nothing has ever sounded that raw or that powerful since.
Right up there with Made in Japan and a couple others is one of the greatest live records.
Word of mouth about the album reached America, where an enthusiastic young musician was starting a fan club.
I was flying the flag for Motorhead, certainly louder than anybody else. The Motorhead was one of the main reasons that I wanted to start a band myself and play music. You should never forget those moments.
But back in London, a tragedy was about to engulf his roommate Andy that Lemmy would never forget.
You know, he gave me a room in his house, you know, where nobody else would come near me, you know. That was great. He was really a good friend to me.
Now Lemmy learned that Andy had been brutally murdered in a gay hate crime.
When they set fire to the room, he crawled out of it and down to the TV room. They found him in the TV room, bled to death, you know. That was awful.
Motorhead's hit-making engine survived this tragedy as it had broken limbs, bad blood, and illegal substances. But when Lemmy decided to record a song with punk heroine Wendy O. Williams, it looked like the band might finally fall apart.
If you consider how awesome, you know, Wendy O. Williams was, just like the punk rock princess provocateur extraordinaire, I personally think any combination of Motorhead and Wendy O. Williams is awesome.
But Fast Eddie didn't think it was such an awesome idea. He refused to play guitar on the track and got kicked out of the band as a result.
I never thought I'd ever leave Motorhead, so the fact that I got pushed out of Motorhead was a bit of a blow.
And it's a shame because he was a marvelous guitarist and a great and vital important part of that band and that sound.
It was unique what we had, and it was a bit special. I miss that. The camaraderie, I miss it. I ain't gonna lie about it.
But when Lemmy brought in Thin Lizzy guitarist Brian Robertson, things got worse.
And he came along to the stage just in these green satin shorts and ballet pumps, right? And a see-through mesh t-shirt.
That's just not the right look.
He looked like the singer in Loverboy.
He said something like, "You know, Rollo, what the f*** are you doing to yourself? You look like an idiot."
A Hell's Angel at a London gig agreed.
When I heard him, he said, "Who's that?" And Trump said, "It's my original guitarist." "Ah, let's kill him." I thought to myself, I think I saved his life.
But not his job. Brian was fired, and Phil Campbell's wife took a surprise phone call.
She said, "Oh, we've had a phone call from the Motörhead people. They wanted to learn 18 songs by Friday." They went, "Oh, God." So I didn't have any albums, so I had to borrow one from Persian Risk roadie Jonah.
Persian Risk guitar wizard Phil was up against ex-Army Corporal Mick Wurzel-Burstyn for the job.
Before Lemmy came in, the two guys were sort of conspiring already, like, "I'll play this part, you play this part, and, you know, maybe he'll pick us both."
I liked Wurzel's guitar playing. Clapton and Lemmy liked Phil Campbell. We couldn't choose between them, so we went for both of them.
But no sooner were Phil Campbell and Wurzel on board than drummer Phil Taylor announced he was leaving the band.
Filthy left because basically he thought that the secret of his future career lay with Brian Robertson.
Yeah, and to get away from Lemmy.
Phil Taylor was replaced by former Saxon drummer Pete Gill. But the world was changing.
You had bands like Bon Jovi coming into view, Motley Crue, Poison, Kix.
Bronze Records decided Motorhead was dead and didn't want another album from the band. Coming up, Lemmy heads for the bright lights of Hollywood, but his best friend leaves the band and the world behind.
I love Wurzel. He was my best friend in the band for ages.
When Behind the Music continues.
Thank you.
Motorhead had established their own brand of balls-to-the-wall heavy metal. But glam metal bands like Poison and Motley Crue were now filling arenas, and the band's record label didn't want another album. Was it all over for Motorhead?
The hair metal and the stuff coming out of L.A. was so popular, and all those bands were playing arenas, that Motorhead kind of got pushed aside.
But Lemmy wasn't that easily pushed aside. He took the album over, and in 1985, No Remorse reached number 14 on the UK charts as the fans came banging back.
We killed them. We just killed them. They were standing around the seats, you know. So vindicated completely, you know.
The band was on a roll. But then in 1987, new boy Pete Gill made the mistake of keeping Lemmy waiting when he called to collect him for rehearsals.
I could see him f***ing around out there, and we were all sitting in the car waiting. It was just the last straw. And he came sauntering out, and I said, hey, you f***ing fired, and he drove off. So that was him.
Happily for Lemmy, Phil Filthy Animal Taylor had discovered that work was hard to get, and he now rejoined the band.
It was like getting back with a girlfriend that you were madly in love with, you know, and you realize you should never have left.
You wanna hear that? What? That's...
But it wasn't a loving reunion for Filthy Phil and his old sparring partner, Phil Campbell.
We were in the dressing room, we were about 30 minutes before we go on. I said, Filthy, you drum like a f-. And he punched me, and there was a step in the dressing room, and my ankle went over and snapped.
Phil Campbell spent the rest of the tour seated on stage. In 1990, Lemmy moved to West Hollywood, where he could indulge in his off-duty passions, Jack Daniels and women. And enjoy his very own customized spot at the end of the bar with his very own video game console.
Here in Los Angeles, he lives basically hop, skip, and a jump from his favorite watering hole, the Rainbow Bar and Grill.
I said to Lemmy one day, why do you live in this apartment? Why don't you get something better? He goes, well, I don't drive. I'm in walking distance to the Rainbow.
The first time I ever met Lemmy, I was in a strip club in Los Angeles. Crazy girls. He looks at me and he says, hey, I'm sorry about your friend Kurt. And to me, it was a perfect thing to say.
Lemmy has also grown closer to his son, Paul. Born in 1965, he grew up with his mother, but has kept in touch over the years, and was even a guest musician on the band's last gig of its 1997 tour.
The nicest thing he ever said to me was very recently when you asked him what is the most precious thing in this room, and he said, my son.
And I was kind of blown away by that. I wasn't expecting that response.
This is my son, Paul. Hey, not bad for an only child. Love me or leave me. Tell me no lies.
Lemmy clearly values his relationship with Paul. But despite sleeping with over 1,000 women and counting, he still shows no sign of settling down.
Sex is the most fun you can have without life.
You're talking about an individual who spends 90% of his time on the road and then the other 10% at the rainbow. I mean, how does one settle down in that environment?
See, I never could figure out a woman that could stop me looking at all the others.
I think, you know, with Lemmy, the road is his mistress.
I think he's a road warrior, and he doesn't know how to get off of that.
I'm not going to say, I'm yours faithfully forever, darling, and then run around, because that's bullshit, you know. I run around, that's what I do.
Three different strippers came up to me. They go, "Was that Lemmy from Motorhead?" I'm like, "Yeah." He goes, "He slept over my house before." I love that. That these 20-year-old strippers, like, "He slept over my house." It's awesome.
But Lemmy left his softer side at home when he decided that bringing Phil Taylor back into the fold had been a mistake.
He kept slowing down and speeding up and forgetting things, you know. And you give him three ultimatums, which is more than most people get, and he didn't improve, so he had to go, you know. You can't have a passenger in a band like mine.
Filthy tells a rather different story involving an old flame of Lemmy's who had become Filthy's girlfriend.
And like an idiot, you know, she called up Lemmy and told him, "I'm with Phil now." And so he fired me because of that. And of course, I said, "You can't fire me, I'm leaving."
With tour dates already booked, Lemmy approached King Diamond drummer Mickey D and asked him to join the band. But there was little time for rehearsal, as Phil and Lemmy had previous commitments.
Lem was at Crazy Girls, and Phil and Verso was at Cat and the Fiddle. So I actually had to learn all these songs on the flight to Saratoga, you know, and go up in front of, I don't know, 30, 40,000 people, you know.
But tragically, the new lineup wasn't to be together for long. By 1995, it was clear that Wurzel was finally reaching the end of his journey.
I believe Verso was more rock and roll than the three of us together were. And Verso was the wild guy on stage. He was absolutely nuts. And he was also pretty wild and different, you know, off stage.
He was the kamikaze guitar player, you know. Himself to death in the end, unfortunately. I love Wurzel. He was my best friend in the band for ages, you know.
Wurzel left the band after recording Sacrifice in 1995, a fitting epitaph for his commitment. He would die of a heart attack in 2011, still mourned by his friend.
When he died, he was f***ing awful, you know. I mean, they say the good ones go too early. Well, he was one of them. What are you going to do, you know?
Wurzel's departure unsettled Lemmy, but it had a silver lining. Now Motorhead had their most enduring lineup ever, Lemmy, Phil Campbell, and Mickey D. But they desperately needed to break the stakes.
This great band from England that no one heard of in the States until they did the Aussie tour. So that was a real defining moment.
The Aussie tour put them firmly on the American map.
That is the turning point for them, and that is them at the mountaintop.
For a lot of, you know, young American kids who are looking for something fast, aggressive, and just, you know, more extreme than anything else, Motorhead was that band that ignited them.
Coming up, Motorhead finally gets the respect it deserves, thanks to Metallica.
Just inspiring to play music with them because it's such a vibe.
And old habits die hard. when Behind the Music continues. Motorhead was now in the mainstream with 16 albums and sales of over 25 million behind them and legions of fans worldwide. But the band members were just as combative as ever, both on the road and in the studio.
It's hard to command Motorhead, you know? It's like trying to command a train running down the tracks out of control.
It's basically like being thrown into a war. They were brutal to me. They would do everything they could to belittle me. Basically saying, are you worthy to be with us?
Can you still get it up? Or are we pushing too hard? I think if you ever had a beautiful girl, you had to use your MasterCard.
The studio security cameras showed who else was helping out with the recording sessions.
You know, there was women in dressed at times running through the halls, and, you know, I'd get a call and have to go up and see security, and we can't have this, you know? Gotta wear clothes in this place.
I don't know who you are. I don't know your name. But if you want to live, you better learn the game.
In January 2005, the record industry that had for so long ignored Motorhead and all that the band stood for finally had to acknowledge them, giving them the Best Metal Performance Award at the Grammys.
And the Grammy goes to, oh yeah, Whiplash, Motorhead.
Heavy metal was right out of favor then, anyway, you know. Because we were lucky we got it.
In a bizarre rock and roll full circle, Motorhead won the Grammy for a cover version of Whiplash, a song written and recorded by Metallica.
What's up?
Hello, sir.
Then on September 14th, 2009, Lars and the band brought a very special guest on stage in Nashville.
And here is the godfather of heavy metal. From Motorhead, the one and only Lemmy Kilmister.
He's kicked the door open for a lot of bands that were feeling like they wanted more.
Lemmy, 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 Lemmy.
If there wasn't a Motorhead, there wouldn't be a Metallica.
Sharing the stage with him, and I mean, it's always fun and it's always just inspiring to play music with him because it's such a vibe.
Also on stage with Lemmy was his other steadfast companion of 40 years, his Rickenbacker bass.
I like the shape of it for a start because it's so weird, you know, it's very eccentric.
You hear 2 seconds of his bass and you think, hey, that's Lemmy.
He's a fantastic bass player and he's got like a strumming style with his right hand, but his left hand is as fast as anybody's.
He's an outlaw with his instrument. But there's also class in there too.
Since then, thanks in part to this class, the band has remained a constant touring and recording machine. But they are no less scary than when they started out.
A lot of them actually thought I was some West Coast poser rocker, you know? And Lemmy stood up for me. He said, you know, get the f*** out of my dressing room if you're gonna talk bad about my drummer.
The various lineups of Motorhead have made a determined musical journey through a land of fights and fury, deafening decibels, backstage Babylon, drugs, and women. So nearly 40 years on, what does the future hold for the band?
Motorhead stop? They're gonna outlive all of us.
We're like a nightmare. We keep coming back.
Motorhead has survived because Lemmy said on Iron Fist, don't let them grind you down.
They're sort of like the cockroach of rock and roll, you know? They're dirty, disgusting, destructive, but you have to give them all due respect because they have outlived so many people and may outlive us all.
And how will the man who has led Motorhead from London in the 70s to international respect and recognition today be remembered?
Lem. Being an old bastard.
A straight shooter. I mean, no bull. No bull with Lemmy.
He lives rock and roll. Everybody wishes you could drink your Jack, smoke your cigarettes, and do the things he does, and do all these women all around the world all your life, every day on 11. You know what I mean? He lives the life that you see every day.
He'll be Keith Richards times 10, where people say, Keith Richards, what a badass, and he, you know, oh my God, what a rebel. No one comes close to Lemmy. And nothing against Keith, but not even gonna be close.
He went into industry, did it his own way, exposed everything for what it is, and stayed Motorhead.
A genuine rock and roll hero, and somebody who was sincere, didn't take any didn't get pushed around, did what he wanted to do, and was a genuinely good guy doing it.
He never got fluffed out. He never got Gucci'd. He doesn't want that lifestyle of limos and people standing there with cameras flashing at it. So he's still like the real guy.
Because most rock stars are full of a lot of it's smoke and mirrors, you know? He's 100% for real.
He just tells you as he feels, which is what I admire about him, because he don't give a shit if you're Elvis or Ozzy. He'll tell you what he thinks, you know?
No bullshit. I'm proud of being honest, if I can, you know, and I'm proud of being a gentleman, which is, I know, both kind of irrelevant these days, but I'm quite proud of them, you know. If they are virtues, then I got them. Apart from that, they can all go f*** themselves.